Hello students, welcome to the capsule program on service oriented architecture. In this capsule program, we are going to understand what is service and the basic principles of service oriented architecture. So let's begin. First of all, we are going to understand what is a service. Service is a function that is well-defined, self-contained, platform-independent, and does not depend on the context or state of other services. So it's a self-made or self-contained entity. We will understand with some examples. Let's take an example of an offline service. Let's take an example of restaurant food service. Typically, when you visit any restaurant, the first service which you come across is the table reservation service. After that, menu selection service, then order processing, then actually cooking and serving that particular order, and finally the billing. So if you see a restaurant food service, this particular service is composed of many sub-services such as table reservation, menu selection, order, cooking and serving and billing. So this is just an example. One more example to understand a service. Take an example of ticket booking at multiplex for movie ticket booking. So typically this particular service starts with a sub-service, that is searching for a multiplex or a particular movie which you want to watch. After that, you just check the time slots, which time slot is comfortable to you. Again, it's a kind of a service. Checking availability of the seats at the desired multiplex. Selection of any particular food combo along with the movie ticket which is offered by that particular multiplex, and then finally initiating the payment. So again, if you look at the multiplex ticket booking service, many other services are working in integration with each other for this particular service. So typically a service can be viewed from three different entities angle: service registry, service requester, and a service provider. So if you see this particular image or this particular diagram, a service requester typically requests a service from the service provider, provided that particular service is registered or published at a global platform. So service registry is nothing but a central repository where all the services are registered or published. And after those services are registered or published, the requester can actually look up for that particular service in the registry. And once that particular service is looked upon, or once that particular service is found by the requester, that is requested from the concerned provider. And then the provider will actually bind that particular service or respond to that particular service requested by the service requester. So requester is nothing but a consumer, and this is nothing but your service provider. So basically, these are the three entities involved in availing any service. So making it very easy or making it very simple, you can just take an example of yellow pages or a directory, phone directory. You can take an example of to understand what is service registry. Typically, when there was an era of landline connections, those landline connections actually used to have the yellow pages or the phone directory along with it. And it was nothing but a kind of, a repository of all the contacts. Like it can be the contacts of manufacturer, the various shopkeepers, the service providers. So in those days, it can be called as a service registry or the phone directory. Now just have a look at various principles or service orientation principles. We will touch upon every principle here in this particular video. First is standardized service contract. Second, service reusability, service discoverability, service composability, service loose coupling, service abstraction, service statelessness, and service autonomy. So let's start one by one. Standardized service contract. Now, what is the meaning of this particular principle? Basically, in availing any service from the provider, the consumer or the requester has to undergo, or rather, the requester has to sign in certain contracts. On the basis of those contracts, the requester can request the particular service from the provider and then can avail that particular service. So in terms of SOA, that particular contract is called as SLA, that is service level agreement. That service level agreement happens between a client, that is the requester, and the provider. So it purely depends on what kind of service the client is seeking from the provider. And accordingly, the various terms and conditions are mentioned in this particular document, which is called as service level agreement. Now let us talk about service reusability. Now here I have taken an example of a car or from automobile sector. If you see, there are many segments of cars where this reusability happens at a great extent. Like you can take an example of the Fiat engine, which is used by MG Hector, which is also used by Tata Motors, and Maruti Suzuki also was using the same engine for its diesel segment cars. So it's an example of reusability of a service. Here you can see a reusability example from the software development angle. Now, with this particular image, you can see that these are the three different development stages like happening with respect to project 1, project 2, and project 3. Now, these are the three various projects which are developed in this particular image or which can be seen developed in this particular image. If you just observe this particular diagram, there are various components which can be utilized or reused for some other projects. From this diagram also, you can understand that this project 4, 5, 6, they can actually utilize the components or maybe the modules which were developed during the development cycle of project 1, 2, and 3. So this is just an example of software reusability. Talking about service discoverability. Now, this particular principle is very important. Unless and until your service is accurately defined, clearly documented, centrally stored, and the requester can be able to access it easily, effectively searched, and clearly understood, it will not be reached till the consumers or the requesters. So this particular principle is very, very important, that your service should be easily discoverable by the requester. Service composability. Actually, service composition is nothing but a form of service reuse only. And just before some time, we discussed about the examples of service reusability. Service loose coupling. Now, loose coupling actually talks about the dependency between the components. And there are two types, loose coupling and tight coupling. In loose coupling, the dependency is quite less. All the service components are functioning independent to each other. But in case of tight coupling, that dependency is much greater. We can say that it is at a high level. So in service loose coupling, from this particular image, you can see an example of a Java interface. There is one Java interface named as device, and below you can see there are various classes, CD player, DVD player, and voice recorder. Now these classes can actually function independent to the interface, right? So this is an example of loose coupling from your Java programming language. Now talking about service abstraction. Service abstraction actually talks about hiding the complexity from the requester, which is not at all required for the requester to know about, right? So we are going to talk about four different types of service abstractions: technology information abstraction, functional information abstraction, quality of service information, and programming logic information. So these are the four types of service abstraction. What is the takeaway from this particular slide? That the requester need not know what is the technology behind the service, or what kind of technology is used to build that particular service, how the functions of that particular service, functionalities of that particular service is implemented, then to provide the quality of service, what kind of system resources are utilized under that particular service, what kind of programming logic information is used. The requester or the consumer is not at all interested to know it. So service abstraction actually deals with hiding all this kind of complexities from the requester. Service statelessness. The aim of this particular characteristic is to design scalable services by separating them from their state data whenever possible. Now here I have given an example, a generic user with stateless information and a stateful information. If you look at stateless information, no session related information is maintained, no login details, we can take example of order processing system, no card details are maintained and the contents are static. But whereas in stateful, you can see the session details, the login details, even in case of online shopping, the card details are maintained and of course the contents are dynamic. So these are the two types we need to understand if you want to understand what is service statelessness. And as it is mentioned in the point itself, that the aim of this particular characteristic is what? To design scalable services. So of course, if the services are stateless, then the resource consumption would be less and the systems would be more scalable to cater to the needs of the requesters. Service composability, yes, we have already talked about. And finally, we will talk about service autonomy. Now, what do you mean by autonomy? Autonomy represents ability to self-govern. There are two types of autonomies, design time autonomy and run time autonomy. What do you mean by design time autonomy? The freedom service owner has to make changes to a service over its lifetime without impacting their service consumers. Now, a very good example of design time autonomy can be like there are many online services or there are many online applications also where the new features are launched without disturbing the existing ones. Or you can even take example of WhatsApp. In WhatsApp, there are many new features are actually launched by the provider, but the basic functionality is always kept intact. So that's nothing but the design time autonomy. And runtime autonomy represents the amount of control a service has over its execution environment at runtime. Runtime autonomy is achieved by providing dedicated processing resources to the service. It's the aim of runtime autonomy is to know or is to predict the behavior of the system. And to predict the behavior of the system, the service should be given some kind of dedicated resources. So that it can run seamlessly and it will not have any impact due to lack of any kind of resources. So that's nothing but the runtime autonomy. So here we have reached to the end of capsule program day one. Today we have discussed about various principles of service-oriented architecture and what is service, right? Thank you for watching and of course keep watching next videos.